आईएनएस टीवी में आपका स्वागत है। मैं हूं दीपक शर्मा, एग्जीक्यूटिव एडिटर। देश की सबसे बड़ी अदालत हो सुप्रीम कोर्ट और या फिर देश की सबसे बड़ी पंचायत पार्लियामेंट, एक आवाज जिसकी तूती बोलती है, आज उसी से हम रूबरू करेंगे आपको। कपिल सिब्बल, कांग्रेस के दिग्गज नेता, देश के पूर्व कैबिनेट मिनिस्टर और जाने माने वकील, और हमारे साथ हैं इंडो एशियन न्यूज सर्विस के एडिटर इन चीफ संदीप बामजाई। बामजाई साहब, पहला सवाल आप ही।
सिब्बल साहब, स्ट्रेट ऑफ द बैट, यू हैव सेड दैट द सीए डज नॉट नेसेसरली इम्पिंज ऑन द फंडामेंटल राइट्स, बट टेकन टुगेदर विद एनपीआर एंड एनआरसी there is an issue.
No, I never said that.
Okay.
In fact, if you
this morning's piece,
there's a piece in the Times of India where I explain, and I say that if you look at the history of grant of citizenship in this country or in the democratic world, you will find that religion has never been the basis, and this is contrary to the basic structure of the constitution. See, what is the basis of grant of citizenship? That you were born in India.
Correct.
Now, you may be born a Muslim, a Buddhist, a Hindu, or Christian, whatever. Or that your parents were born in India.
True.
Parents may be Muslim, Hindu, or anybody. Or that you have been in residence here.
Mm-hmm.
You may be in residence for 10 years as a Muslim, Hindu, or anybody. So, both under the Constitution and under the Citizenship Act of 1955, religion has never been the basis. This is the first time in our country that religion has been made the basis for grant of citizenship. So there is a fundamental constitutional issue which is now pending in the Supreme Court, and this is the basis of that challenge. Apart from that, the whole NPR issue and the National Register of Indian Citizens, right, will actually integrate into the CAA, right?
Mm.
So the NPR will be the basis, and then of course the NRIC will be prepared.
Mm-hmm.
And the NPR is going to be prepared in such a fashion that a low-level officer will be entitled to say that I doubt the citizenship of this particular individual.
Mm-hmm.
The Home Minister in Parliament says that, look, I give an assurance.
That's right.
But that assurance of no value,
mm-hmm.
because under Rule 4.4 of the rules, pursuant to a notification issued by the Government of India under the citizen, under the Act, the power is given to the local registrar, and the power is given to the enumerator to doubt the citizenship of anybody, even if that assurance...
But he has maintained that there is no doubt. He keeps saying that there is no doubt regarding this.
But there is Rule 4.4 which says that he can be doubted by the officer concerned. So how does his assurance take away the statutory rule? Unless he abrogates it.
So, we now have a situation where several states have passed resolutions against it.
Yes.
The matter, as you said rightly, is pending in the Supreme Court. Where do you think this is headed? Because what we've seen over time, particularly since this came into existence, is that India is once again divided.
Absolutely.
After so many years, we are seeing a situation where India stands divided.
Not just divided, we are really looking at non-issues. The real issues before this country: coronavirus, massive economic downturn, right?
Mm-hmm.
The global economy probably will go into a recession.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah.
No jobs, no earnings, so no revenues for government. The government has to make expenditures. Where are they going to get expenditures from? Right? NPAs are rising. So you sell your house silver, silver of your nation.
True.
Right? Sell them for a song. And you sell them to foreign entities. So really, the East India Company is coming back in this manner by way of multinationals or big corporations buying up real estate in India, buying up assets in India. Why is the nation concerned about NRIC in the midst of this crisis? I don't understand.
So you would like this to be abrogated, or you
no,
would?
No, I think the Prime Minister's statement must be honored that there will be no NRIC.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's going to be no NRIC, there need not be any population register, right, to determine whether a person is a citizen or not.
But if the Supreme Court actually declares this null and void?
No, Supreme Court is not even hearing the matter. We've been requesting the Supreme Court this process is going to start of enumeration on the 1st of April, ends on the 30th of September. So please at least hear the matter for a couple of hours before that. Hopefully now, you know, I don't know in this situation whether it can be heard or not.
Two quick questions, because we have you as a legal luminary sitting with us. One, propriety. And do you think that the Chief Justice of India should accept a position like this only 4 months after retiring? And this, there's a precedent, because the same government appointed Chief Justice Sathasivam as a governor. And I don't remember Chief Justices being given sinecures in this manner in the past.
Look, let's not go into the legality of it. I think that that will be the wrong question to ask and the wrong answer for me to give. The issue was of public perception.
Correct.
The issue is confidence of the people on the judicial system, right? Now, we have seen a lot of controversies qua Ranjan Gogoi when he was Chief Justice of India. Very unsavory controversies, right? Mm-hmm. One particular day on a holiday, he presides over a bench in the Supreme Court in respect of his own cause. And then a judicial order comes where his signature is not there, and he gives a defense, you know, sitting in court number one. It's unheard of, right? And there are many other issues. He is the one who went along with three other judges and talked about future generations will not spare us unless we tell the people of this country that the institution is in danger, right? So, and he's the one who says that if any judge accepts an appointment after retirement, it'll be a blot on the institution. So having said all that, then accepting this is nothing to do with law. It's something to do with credibility.
लेकिन आज आपने उनकी जो तुलना है वो आपने जस्टिस खन्ना को बीच में आप लिया है।
हाँ, मैंने अपने उसकी क्या वजह है? कहा कि जस्टिस खन्ना साहब को हम क्यों याद रखते हैं? क्योंकि वो जो मेजॉरिटी का फैसला था, उसमें वो डिसेंट उन्होंने किया। आर्टिकल 21 के प्रति उन्होंने कहा कि भाई 21 जो है वो सस्पेंड नहीं हो सकता क्योंकि लाइफ और लिबर्टी कैन नॉट बी सस्पेंडेड. फैसला वो मेजॉरिटी उनके खिलाफ था, लेकिन आज हम केवल खन्ना साहब को याद करते हैं. क्यों करते हैं? क्योंकि फैसला बेशक कानून के नज़रिए में सही हो, लेकिन जनता के नज़रिए में गलत था.
लेकिन एक
तो ये अगर अपॉइंटमेंट होती है और वो कहते हैं कि कानून के नज़रिए में सही है, नहीं, ये सवाल गलत है.
लेकिन सिब्बल साहब, कांग्रेस में एक आरोप ये भी है कि रंगनाथ मिश्र थे और उन्होंने सिख दंगों का जो आयोग था उसकी उन्होंने जांच करी थी और उनको कांग्रेस लेके आई, तो इसमें क्या अंतर, मिश्रा और गगोई में क्या अंतर है?
मैं आपको इसका भी जवाब देता हूँ. देखिए, जो सरकारों का तबादला क्यों होता है, सरकारें बदलती क्यों हैं? इसलिए बदलती हैं कि पिछली सरकारों ने कुछ गलतियाँ की होंगी, तो नई सरकार होनी चाहिए, उनको वो गलती नहीं दोहरानी चाहिए. तो ये तो ऐसा हो गया कि जब, जैसे परिवार देहात में कभी होता है कि तूने मेरे बहनोई को मारा था, तो मैं आज तेरे बहनोई को भी मार दूंगा, ठीक है ना? और अगर कोर्ट ऑफ लॉ में जाएगा तो न्यायाधीश क्या कहेगा? मारना तो गलत है ना. तो ये कौन सी आर्ग्यूमेंट हुई कि रंगनाथ मिश्रा को या सदाशिवम को नियुक्ति दी गई एज गवर्नर और रंगनाथ मिश्रा को 7 साल के बाद राज्यसभा में लाया गया? तो आपका ये मतलब है कि अगर 2002 में दंगे हुए तो आप कहेंगे 84 में हुए, तो इसका मतलब आगे भी होने चाहिए? क्या ये नज़र सरकार का नज़रिया है? तो मैं, ये भी सवाल गलत है. जो चीज़ गलत है वो गलत है.